Welcome all of you to the 39th live webinar on orthopedic principles. This time we have Dr. Ajith Appuhamy from Sri Lanka once again with us. He is going to enlighten us on polytrauma with respect to the fellowship exam. Over to you, Dr. Appuhamy. You can share your screen.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everybody. Yeah, can you see me, my slides and everything?
Yes. Yes, please.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. Okay. So polytrauma, it's a very common topic in FRCS trauma orthopedic exam, especially in the VIVA. It's a common VIVA topic in the adult trauma and even the basic science topic table. They commonly ask about polytrauma management, especially acute management. In addition to that, it's quite abundant even in the MCQ paper. So I have organized my lecture mainly focused on FRCS trauma orthopedic exam. So what I do in this lecture, initially I will create the background knowledge, basically the foundation for the related to the polytrauma. Then after that, I will discuss what are the possible questions they asked in trauma orthopedic exam and how do you proceed for the answer. So initially I will create the background knowledge. Then I will step by step, I will explain you how to answer a question in a polytrauma table, polytrauma VIVA. So we'll start our discussion with the definition, because you need to know the definitions. Usually what is polytrauma? Because it's very important to identify the polytrauma, differentiate from multiple fractures. Because there is a possibility of asking the definition in exam. So it is a syndrome of multiple injuries with systemic traumatic reaction, which may lead to dysfunctions of organ or dysfunctions of vital organs. So when you tell it about polytrauma, it should be at least two systems, at least two body regions should be involved. Now, if you divide the body to head and neck and cervical spine, face, chest, thoracic, abdomen, lumbar region, limbs, pelvis, and external organs, skin mainly. So out of these areas should be two areas involved concurrently, then we can say it is a polytrauma. Now imagine you get a patient with a femur fracture, tibial fracture, and patellar fracture. We can't tell that is a polytrauma patient because it's a multiple fracture. If patients have in other rest of the whole systems is intact, so we don't call it polytrauma, we call it multiple fracture. Next thing is, according to the abbreviated injury score, I will tell what it is exactly in the latter part of my lecture. So abbreviated injury score, if it is more than 3, we call it polytrauma. I marked it as red because that is the MCQ point. They will ask in exam, polytrauma, the one stem should be abbreviated score more than 3. So you have to take it as a true stem. Other thing is injury severity score is more than 15. Again, we call it polytrauma. Don't worry about this scoring method because I will discuss the latter part of my discussion. When you go to the latest definition, that definition has expanded according to the current consensus, that what they are telling, it should be injury to the two or more body part or systems that will result in cognitive, physical, psychological, and psychosocial impairment. When you talk a little bit about the prevalence, it is a worldwide number one cause of death among young generation, young age group. It is the third most common death in all age group. Now we get into the small, very important area. When you talk about the polytrauma, as I said before, I'm now making the background knowledge before entering my proper exam question. So when you talk about polytrauma, we need to discuss this term that is multidisciplinary approach, which is mandatory. We need to talk about that. If you forget this term, if you forget this important buzzwords, and if you're going to discuss about polytrauma, you will not gain any answer or pass mark for your discussion. So multidisciplinary approach, because there are multiple specialties should involve for the patient management. Orthopedic surgeon as a trauma surgeon, physicians, consultant anesthetics, intensive care physicians, and therapy, physiotherapist, if need, GU surgeon, if necessary, general surgeon, and at last but not least, interventional radiologist. When you talk about polytrauma in orthopedic injuries, generally not life-threatening unless they result in significant blood loss, significantly hemodynamic unstable. So we have to remember, even the polytrauma, we have to think about hemodynamic instability. Now we'll get into the what are the trimodal deaths in polytrauma. There are three types of death we talk in polytrauma. First P, that's on the spot. That means at the site of the location of the injury, patient will die due to major neurovascular injury. They will die. That is the first type, immediate death. Second is a second peak death. That means while transferring the patient to the hospital, within 1 or 2 or within 4 hours, patient will die due to intracranial hematoma, major thoracic or abdominal injury. That is second peak death. Third one is a sepsis and multi-organ failure. That is the death we can avoid doing proper resuscitation. That happens later, after 2 or 3 weeks. That part I will discuss in more details in my discussion. This is the graph, that trimodal distribution. As I said to you before, that first peak death, that means immediate death, quite common, about 50%. Then go to the second peak death, that happens within hours while after transferring the patient to the trauma center. That's about 30%. And the latter death, that is the third one, is about 20% due to sepsis and multi-organ failure. I have highlighted these first two type of deaths, that 50% and 30%, altogether 80%, that we can prevent to a certain extent if you transport patient, if you do the appropriate treatment immediately transfer into the patient to the trauma center, we can prevent that kind of. I will talk in detail what is golden hour. So this third type of death, if you stick onto the proper resuscitation principles, and if we take correct, accurate decisions according to the patient's evaluation, then we can avoid this third type of death. Then I will step into the pathophysiology of the trauma. This part is very important to understand the trauma management part. So this is my graph. I will show in my x-axis, y-axis, x-axis the time. My y-axis, I will show the inflammatory response. Now we all know, whatever the injury happened to our body, we have our inflammatory system in our body. So suddenly that increase that stimulate our inflammatory system, and that start inflammatory response. So what happened? Now you can see my graph, I have divided into the blue area and the red area. This is the blue area, that is a normal area. Usually once the injury happened, that is called first hit happened, trauma happened, this increased steeply, that inflammatory response, but it is confined to this reversible area that is called safe zone. And then it will come back. It will it will come back if you do the proper resuscitation. We have to be very careful. If it is going to this red zone, that is a bit of dangerous and it is life-threatening, it can lead to multi-organ failure and adult respiratory distress syndrome. So this is a natural curve of our inflammatory response to a trauma. Now imagine, once the trauma happened, on top of that trauma, once the patient takes to the theater, now imagine patient has got a femur fracture, pelvic fracture, and some other chest injuries. Patient has got an inflammatory response against this trauma. On top of that, if you are planning to do the lengthy surgical procedures, for instance, like intramedullary nailing for the femur fracture, what happened? We are deliberately doing a second hit for the patient. Even though it's a surgery, it's a therapeutic, curative procedure, for the patient's body, for our body, it's another attack. So what happens? That will exaggerate our inflammatory system again, and the possibility of entering into this red zone, dangerous zone, is more likely. Once it's entered this dangerous zone, red zone, there's less chance of reversing back to the normal level. So it is not compensatory. So in my third paragraph, I will nicely show, so with due to first hit, it will steep up. And due to second hit, it will exaggerate again and it's sent into the red zone. So it cannot come back to normal. It remains at the red zone. So patient will end up with multi-organ failure. This is the normal physiology. You need to understand in trauma situation and the trauma management. Another important thing is the trauma triad of death. That is hypothermia, coagulopathy, metabolic acidosis. This is the area they frequently ask question in the MCQ paper. And even the Viva table, you need to know about this. This act as a vicious cycle. You know, if there is a blood loss, patient become hypothermic. Once become hypothermic due to massive blood loss, loss of platelets, RBC, clotting factor, that affects the clotting cascade. So it will develop coagulopathy. Then due to coagulopathy, that will compromise the circulation and develop acidosis and develop metabolic acidosis. This metabolic acidosis will compromise the heart function and depress the cardiac performance and reduce circulation. Again, that will reduce hypothermia. That will increase hypothermia. So that acts as a vicious cycle. So you need to know this trimodal death, because we always try to protect the patient before entering into this trimodal stage. When you discuss the goal of management, our main target is to restoration of the normal physiology. Our resuscitation to get the patient to pre-injury status. When you are managing, when you are restoring the physiology, we give priorities. First, we'll try to save the life, because that is very important, because patient should survive first. Then limb salvage, and later on we think about the functional protection, if possible. So, as I said to you before, that trimodal death, 50% occur before reach to the hospital, 30% after reaching within 4 hours, 20% later. So we can avoid, I discussed about this slide before, we can avoid this 80% if you stuck to the golden hour principle. And this 20% we can avoid by sticking to proper resuscitation principles and getting accurate decisions during resuscitation. Okay, that's all I need to discuss with you as a foundation knowledge. Now I will get into the exam situation. And this one fact you should know in your VIVA, in your trauma orthopedic exam, and how to make your proper wording, how to use your buzzwords in front of your examiner, and how to impress your examiner. Usually the trauma VIVA, they will give this, show you a this, actually this is a true story what happened to me. They showed me this kind of, not this exactly this picture, but this kind of significant pelvic trauma x-ray, pelvic fracture, and patient, this examiners, okay, how do you manage this patient acutely? You need to listen to examine exactly what he says. The patient says, what is your acute management plan? So you should not jump and tell about pelvic fracture, type of pelvic fracture, how to manage a pelvic fracture, pelvic reconstruction. No. Then you are totally out of the track. Because examiner specifically showing this picture, and if examiner wants to explain you this x-ray, he will tell you, okay, explain what you see in the x-ray. No, what the question was, how to manage this patient acutely. Acute management, they asked. So you need to start your answer telling some brief statement related to the x-ray. You can tell, okay, I can see a complex comminuted pelvic fracture. This is probably a high energy trauma. That is the way you need to start. Then you can emphasize the patient, you know the pathway. Now you use it's a complex injury, and you use that is a high energy trauma. And next thing you need to tell, I will assess this patient according to ATLS protocol and Bose guideline for the pelvic fracture management. So that two words, that buzzwords are very important. If you do not mention ATLS protocol, if you do not mention Bose guideline related to the pelvic fracture in acute care setup, so there is a very least possibility to get through your exam. You need to know about ATLS protocol. Now, when you talk, now I will explain a little bit here about ATLS protocol, not in detail, because I'm not going to explain you about ABCD here. I will explain what are the important facts you need to emphasize for your examiner. In the ATLS protocol, you know there are four steps. It's a primary survey and resuscitation, secondary survey, evaluation, and the definitive care. In the ATLS protocol, when you start the rapid primary resuscitation, that is interrelated steps. You know, it's not by one after one steps. So you need to emphasize that. And next thing is a rapid primary survey that is mainly targeted to find the primary killer. What is the killer of this particular trauma patient? You need to find out. And simultaneously, you do the resuscitation to treat what is killing patient. That is very important, you need to tell related to the ATLS protocol. Once you do the resuscitation, once the patient move into a proper track and little bit establishment, stabilize the patient, then you can do the secondary survey, head to toe examination to find any other related injuries. And the third one is a constant evaluation, constant re-evaluation. You need to evaluate patient in every 5 minutes. That is very, very important. That's why I have highlighted this statement, because you need to, that is a keyword in the primary resuscitation. In ATLS, you need to constant re-evaluation is very important, because According to re-evaluation and its outcome only, we can proceed further whether to go ahead with the proper total care or whether to need further resuscitation or whether to go for a damage control procedure. So if you mention about these two facts according to your ATLS protocol, then that is more than enough. I don't believe they will ask about what is A, what is B, A, B, C, D, E, F in FRCS level. Then we move into the BOST guideline. In British Orthopaedic Association, they have separate guidelines for the acute management for the pelvic fracture. You need to know about that, no doubt about that. But I don't believe they will ask this all 15 steps from you. I know it is a daunting task to remember all these steps. What I did, I categorize, because this all this included, I will discuss the BOST guideline main facts in the latter part of my study, latter part of my discussion. So I will categorize this BOST guideline mainly says initially it's the field level. In the field level, what you have to do. Then what is the resuscitation measures you have to do in the hospital in that AME? Then what is the care? Is the definitive damage control, early total care, and the post-operative care. Those are the three main areas they divide and discuss under BOST guideline. That BOST guideline, I will emphasize few more important facts. You have to read it slowly and then you will understand. According to BOST guideline, they are telling the in the field level, the paramedics doing a great job. They need to identify if they are suspecting any pelvic fracture, they need to apply a pelvic bind immediately. And they need to transfer immediately if they suspect the patient is having hemodynamically unstable. They need to inform nearby trauma center and transfer the patient. Because that is very important to get the maximum benefits of your Galtenauer principle. If you inform and transfer the patient, then the trauma hospital, trauma A&E knows, okay, this patient is, they are anticipating to get the patient and they are completely ready. That will reduce the further delay of the resuscitation. Then once the patient resuscitates, there are a few resuscitation measures. I will discuss it later. That is more important. That is the core of this lecture. So then after doing that, they do the imaging, what they recommend in the BOST guideline, do the CT scan if facility is available, go for IV contrast CT scan from head to toe. Mainly chest, head, chest, abdomen, pelvis. Another important fact, what they are telling after resuscitation, we have to post binder. That means after binder removal, we have to get the X-ray again. Because of the binder, they can mask many catastrophic pelvic ring fractures. So another that's an important fact they emphasize in the BOST guideline. Then resuscitation, then decision to whether to go for early total care or damage control. And the post-operative care they discuss about. Physiotherapy, thromboprophylactic treatment, and rest of the management. And next thing is they emphasize about the multidisciplinary approach well in this BOST guideline. I will discuss it later in my latter slide. So that I briefly discuss about ATLS and BOST guideline. Now I will come back to my answer again. I started my answer, this is a complex injury. I will assess according to ATLS protocol and the BOST guideline. Then I will mention, because I said you before, usually in trauma patient, in orthopedic wise, pure orthopedic will not be a life threatening. Because if it's an orthopedic fracture which associated with bleeding, it will be life threatening. That's so hypovolemic shock is the main problem in this trauma patient. So I will emphasize that I particularly concerned about that hypovolemic shock management of this patient. That is the key thing. Then examiner will understand, okay, this candidate is moving to a correct track. When you go into the hypovolemic shock management, there are primary hemostatic resuscitation measures. That is the keyword you need to use. There are four primary hemostatic resuscitation methods. First thing is pelvic binder. Second one is a tranexamic acid, massive transfusion protocol, and permissive hypertension. What is the main target of this resuscitation? Primary resuscitation is to initiate the clot. Now, problem is the bleeding. So we need to address that. Initiate the clot and maintain the clot formation, and subsequently it will prevent trauma triad of death, what I discussed with. So that is the ultimate target of primary hemostatic resuscitation. When we move into what is pelvic binder, basically pelvic binder here, it acts as a hemostatic device. It is not a reduction device. Actually, reduction is a bonus. We put the pelvic binder to get the tamponade effect, because a lot of pelvic fractures, they're bleeding from venous bleeding, because venous wall is much more thinner. So if we compress the external, when we increase the external pressure that reduce the volume of the venous vessels, veins, and that will compromise, that will stop bleeding. So we need to apply the pelvic binder in the proper positioning. Probably they will ask in the exam, how do you apply the pelvic binder? You need to tell slightly internal rotate, and the pelvic binder, that sheet should be lie on the GT. If you mention about this keyword under pelvic binder, I think that's more than enough. When you go to the tranexamic acid, that is a very important thing. So we need to give that as early as possible in our resuscitation process. It has antifibrinolytic action that will promote and stabilize the clot formation. That is well proven with the CRASH II trial. This asks in your exam. CRASH II trial is a large international randomized control multicenter study. It is well proven. It is reduce the risk of death in bleeding patient, and it reduce the risk of mortality. If we need to know is there any contraindications of the patient? If there's no contraindication, you can give a tranexamic acid bolus dose, 2 mg. If you give the early as possible, less than 1 hour, is more benefit. If it is more than 3 hours, it gives less benefit. Third step is a massive transfusion protocol. This is something new protocol came up with, and it is that depending on the trust, it varies. Because different trusts have different transfusion protocol, different massive transfusion protocol. It's a commonly used with the, because if here problem is a loss of blood, we need to replace blood from blood, not from any other substitute, not from colloids, not from crystalloids. What happens if you give colloids or crystalloids? That will dilute our circulation, that will dilute the remaining blood. And next thing is that will proceed to blow out our clot, blow out our first clot. Because first clot is very important to stabilize the circulation, stop bleeding. So if we dilute, what happens? That will blow out our initial clot. So it is important to do the blood transfusion, but it's a RBC platelet, fresh frozen plasma, and the cryoprecipitate we give in 1:1:1:1:1:1:1 proportion. RBC for the red blood cell, platelets for the platelet replacement with the FFE to the fibrinogen, cryoprecipitate, it has a lot of clotting factors. What will happen? This FFE, it has a lot of fibrinogen, that will initiate clot formation. That initiate clot formation, maintenance and propagation happen by clotting factor, which is coming from cryoprecipitate. So that is why very important with the massive transfusion, we need to assess. That is why I mentioned constant reevaluation. It should be clinical and it should be the investigation one. I will come in later in that part in detail. Fourth step is a permissive hypertension. This is very important. We should not be targeting high blood pressure reached to 120 systolic in the trauma patient. Because if there is maintaining high blood pressure, that will shoot up our initial clot. Because our target is to protect our initial clot, primary clot, and maintain it and propagate and to stop bleeding. And in addition to that, at meantime, we need to maintain our circulations to vital organ to make the survival, to keep life safe. So systolic blood pressure, we can keep 90, because that 90 blood pressure, that will not dislodge our initial clot, and that 90 systolic blood pressure can maintain the vital circulation to vital organ. That is why permissive hypertension. If you explain this primary resuscitation four steps, I think you probably reach up to 6-7 level marks. In addition to that, you should not avoid inotropes, and I already mentioned collagen crystallized. When you come to the constant evaluation, we have to assess the patient GCS level, blood pressure, and clotting factors. Clotting factors, APTT, PTINR, those things, traditional method, it takes time to assess. The problem is in the acute state, we have to reevaluate constantly and frequently. So there are so many bedside tests like thromboelastography and rotational thromboelastometry that gives a sound idea about the clot and clot formation and the clotting status. Now, the important thing we need to assess is serum lactate level, because I said you before, there are the trauma triad of death, metabolic acidosis. Once it goes to the metabolic acidosis, eventually other two also come and patient will learn to reversible stage. So serum lactate is very important to assess frequently in the constant evaluation process. If the lactate level is less than 2, patient is safe. We can proceed. If you want to go for early total care, I will discuss it later. And if it is actually 2.5 is the demarcation margin, 2 and 2.5. If it's less than 2, patient is in safe side, patient move into the good direction. And if it is 2 and 2.5, it's kind of marginal, then we have to look at the trend of the serum lactate level in the sequential measure. If it is moving, if it is increasing, so we need further resuscitation. If it is going down, so patient moving to less than 2 side, we can think of rest of the management. If it is more than 2.5, that means we cannot go for any further advanced major procedures. We have to do the further resuscitation, and if you want, only we can go for a damage control procedure. That's the 2.5 we discussed, and that's the level we frequently are. That would be questioning in your MCQ paper. And there's another paper recently came out, Valier paper. They came up with this 2.5 came as a 4 as a cutoff level. So if you point out this kind of additional points as a research paper, that will give more marks for your exam. In addition to that, you have to assess the renal profile and the urine output as well. Now, in our exam, we were discussing our answer. So we start our primary resuscitation with the primary hemostatic resuscitation four steps. So after that, once we have to assess whether the patient's response, how it is, whether the patient is a good responder, whether it's a transient responder or it's a non-responder. If it is a good responder, okay, we are happy, we proceed with the management. If it's within 24 hours, patient is very good response, so we can go for early total care. If it's a transient responder, so we can further resuscitate and see what is the trend of the patient. If it is moving in the good side, okay, good, we'll proceed with early total care. If it is not moving, it's not getting bad, then we'll consider it as a non-responder. So if it is a non-responder or transient responder, so if it is not settling with the resuscitation patient, let's move into the hemodynamically stable stage. then we have to get involved our interventional radiologist. We can go for angiographic embolization. Make the embolus and stop bleeding. Otherwise, we can immediately take the patient to the theater and do the pelvic packing or internal iliac cartilagation. If there's a lumbar bone fracture bleeding, we can put the external fixture and make the reduction, and that will compromise the tension of the compartment. And if the grossly contaminated wound, we can go for a debridement. So that kind of a secondary resuscitation measure we can do, but it's we are doing as a primary stage to stabilize the patient. That is the primary resuscitation method. Then once the patient is stable, then come to secondary survey. I said you before, we had to do the head-to-toe examination. Especially in the polytrauma patient. So the X-ray I showed is a pelvic fracture polytrauma patient. So particularly that pelvic fracture patient, you need to know few things. You need to examine few important things and get involved other specialties. That is where we enter into the multidisciplinary site, multidisciplinary approach. So we can assess what is there any abnormal positions of the lower extremities. If it is internally rotated, we suspect any pelvic fracture plus associated femur neck fractures and the pelvic fracture. We address the skin, scrotal, perineal hematoma, because that is quite common in the pelvic fractures, and perineal laceration, and morally valid lesions like subcutaneous degloving lesion. We need to assess the neurological status because it's quite commonly it's possible to involve lumbar and sacral flexus injuries. Important thing here, you need to examine the tip of the urethral meatus. If there's a blood, you should not try to catheterize. You need to get your GU surgeon's opinion and involvement. If there's a urethral meter, there's a high chance of getting urethral injury. So you need to get involved and do the ureteroscopy or cystoscopy and do the catheterization. Another important thing in our full assessment, we should not forget to do a perirectal examination and vaginal examination. Because if you don't do, there's a high chance of masking this occult open fracture. Because if there is an occult open pelvic fracture, our management become grossly deviating, because we need to do the proper debridement. And that is where we need to get involved our general surgeon or colorectal surgeon to get either defunctioning colostomy to get the perineal area clear. That will be helpful to proceed with the nursing care. So these steps you need to mention in as acute state. It comes on the primary resuscitation, then we came to the secondary resuscitation. Then we do the investigations. According to the Bose guideline, they recommend for the scanogram, CT scanogram. Okay, now after resuscitation finished, then we need to assess. I clearly mentioned about the importance of constant evaluation, because we can categorize the patient where the patient is stable. Hemodynamically stable, if all parameters, serological parameters, clotting factors, blood pressure, renal functions, everything stable, we can carry on with early tertiary care. If the patient is borderline, some are good, some are not good, then always we consider that unstable. Then unstable patient and the extreme patient like that, we can categorize. And we put all them under damage control principle, damage control logic. Here, I will discuss a little about damage control orthopedics. And timing of the procedure, I told the once, unless patient is stable, we don't think about early total care. If the patient stays damage control procedure, we leave the window period to get back our inflammatory response to normal. Then only we go for a procedure. So in damage control orthopedic, I'll talk a little bit about evolution of that. It started around 1990s, damage control orthopedics. The main concept is, first thing is to stop ongoing damage. Now imagine the problem is the bleeder, we need to stop bleeding. The problem is the compartment syndrome, we need to release, decompress. We need to release compartments. The problem is a gross contaminator, we need to do the proper debridement. The problem is a displacement or dislocation, we need to reduce the joint or we need to stabilize the joint. Those are the concepts. We don't do any other further intervention. It is very minimal intervention. Other thing is the stabilize the bone and stabilize the physiology. Those are the three concepts in damage orthopedic, damage control of orthopedic. So when you come to the damage control of orthopedic, as I mentioned before, we have to get involved the multidisciplinary team again. First life, then limb, then control bleeding, decompression, contamination, and the sprain for the fractures. Okay. Early total care. In early total care, once the patient is stable, yes, we are allowed to, even the BOS guidelines say we can proceed with early total care within 24 hours. The advantage of it's a good pain relief. Less chance of infection, early stabilization, and subsequently that reduces thromboembolism. But very important thing, now imagine patient is quite stable and patient has a pelvic fracture and surgeon, as an orthopedic surgeon, if you are going to proceed intramedullary nailing at the acute stage, make sure how much patient is stable, we need to proceed it as a constant dynamic approach. That is the key thing you need to mention. In the trauma patient, if you go for early total care, it should be always constant dynamic approach, because we need to assess during procedure patients physiological status, patient's lactate level, patient's blood gas analysis, patient's urine output. If the patient is deteriorating, bail out the procedure, switch into the damage control orthopedic, and resuscitate, transfer the patient to ICU. That's the management plan. That is all you need to know at the acute management. Later on, that examiner needs to discuss about the definitive care. Then he will ask about operative procedures. What are you going to do? How do you reduce this pelvic fracture? How do you open fracture management, vertical shear fracture management, lateral compression fracture management? That he will ask in detail once you've done the proper job in acute. I am not going to discuss here definitive care. I'm here more concerned about trauma part. Here now I move into a different topic, that is TARN. It is quite novel topic, but it will be asking in your exam frequently nowadays. TARN is Trauma Audit and Research Network. It was established in 1990, University of Manchester and Leicester. The main target of this is, it's a kind of auditing method. What we are doing, main target is to increase the trauma care. First, we strict on the protocols, we use many scoring method. We assess the patient's outcome, we assess so many ongoing procedures, and we do some research and we'll assess the outcome, trauma care outcome in our trust. in our hospital. We discuss in our audit meeting, monthly audit meeting, we discuss with the hospital. Then later on, then we can compare with the national system. We can produce our outcome to the national system, and or we can do the comparison with the, our outcome and the national outcome, and we can go up to the national level. That is done. You don't have to know in detail about that. If you know what is done and when this was established and what is the target of the, this, that's more than enough. Okay. Then we'll move into the scoring system in trauma. This area, it's quite commonly questioned in your MCQ paper. Because, again, it's possible in the Viva exam, but there are few more things, few more type of scoring method you need to know in detail. So I will discuss only that particular scoring methods in detail. Otherwise, I will tell a brief idea of the scoring system, and mainly that would be question in your MCQ paper. So scoring method, we can divide physiological, anatomical, and combined. When you come to physiological, there are revised trauma score system that is commonly we use. I will discuss that later. Other thing is Apache, that is acute physiology and chronic health evaluation. SOFA, that is the sequential organ failure assessment. And SIR, systemic inflammatory response syndrome. And last is the emergency trauma score. Those are physiological methods. They frequently ask, okay, select one of physiological scoring system in following types. So you need to select one of them in your exam. This is how they will be questioned in MCQ paper. The anatomical method is abbreviated injury score. You need to know about that. I will discuss in my lab at the end of my lecture. And injury severity score, very important. And anatomical profile and the PATI, that is for general surgeon, for the penetrating abdominal trauma index and other things. Then combined method is a trauma injury severity score, and Ascot method, it is an injury characteristic of the trauma, and ISS, that is the international classification of injury severity score. You need to remember these terms a little bit because it's quite common in your MCQ paper. So why we are using this sort of a score? Mainly for it is important at the triage to appreciate the triage and patient need the priority. Which patient need to transfer to a trauma center? Which patient we can slowly transfer? Which patient need the acute care? Which patient need the early care? Which patient need the damage control trial? To that category, we need this scoring system. Other thing is we can use in this scoring system, we can assess the outcome of the patient. And we can do the accurate counseling to the patient and the family member. Other thing, we can use it for the quality assurance. And most importantly, we can use it as an important research tool. As I discussed before, it's a TARN. We can use this many scoring method in our TARN system. So that we'll use to get a good outcome in our studies and the reimbursement purposes also we can use. So I will discuss the MES score. This is quite important. You need to know when sometimes they will give a picture in the your Viva table. Okay, they will give a little bit details about the patient's blood pressure and the circulation. And say, okay, can you tell me what is roughly MES score of this patient? So you need to know about that. So MES score basically we are using to predict the amputation. Another thing I want to tell, in exam, in scoring method, you need to know what are the pearls and pitfalls of that particular scoring system. Because that is a common Viva question. Now imagine they will ask, okay, RTS, revised trauma scoring system. What are the pearls and pitfalls? You need to know about that. pros and cons. Okay, when you go back to the med score, so there are four main areas we assess here to predict the amputation or salvage after lower limb trauma. So we assess the skeletal and soft tissue injury. We give marks 1, 2, 3, 4. It's a low energy, medium, high, and very high energy. Then we assess the limb ischemia, pulse reduced or absent, but normal perfusion. We give 1 mark, pulseless, 2 marks, and the cold, paralyzed, insensate, numb limb, we give 3. So we assess the blood pressure. If it is more than 90, 0, good. That's what our target according to permissive hypertension. If the patient has a hypertension which is transient, we give 1. If the persistent hypertension, we give 2. Then age less than 30, 30 to 50, 50, we give mark. So out of that, you need to know these facts because these would be MCQs. There's a 100% amputation risk if it is more than 7. This 100% salvage rate is less than 4. Now the important fact you need to know about this med score, if the double the score, if the ischemia time is more than 6. This is the MCQ statement. What is the pros and cons? This med score has a high specificity for predicting amputation. In spite of having low sensitivity, as a disadvantage for the predicting amputation. You need to know about this. This would be MCQ as well. Then when you discuss the revised trauma score, we widely use this as the pre-hospital field trial because this is important to categorize the patient and which patient need early transfer into the early trauma center. So we highly use this as a start triage. 3 categories we assess, 3 parameters. We assess the GCS, we assess the systolic blood pressure, and we assess the respiratory rate. Low score, that means patient is more dangerous, more severe, we need to immediately transfer. So if it is less than 3 score, survival rate is quite low. If it is more than 3 to 10, we need to transfer immediately. That kind of a classification. What is the main advantage of this? This is useful during triage to determine which patient needs to transfer to trauma center. I mentioned that before. And disadvantage, this can underestimate the injury severity in the patient injured in one system. Now imagine, now patient has a lung contusion, severe lung injury, but we cannot assess the severity of that particular system. Injury is underestimating that injury because we assess only GCS, respiratory, and systolic pressure. These things they might commonly ask in your Viva table. Okay, or tell me what is the advantage and disadvantage of RTS. You need to know. Injury severity score. This is very common and you need to know about this. And this again is highly correlated with the mortality, morbidity, and hospitalization time of the trauma. So we define major trauma if the injury severity score is more than 15. It is MCQ. And when you come to this injury severity score, we measure, I will explain how to measure there by using the abbreviated injury score. That is the anatomical based consensus derived from the global severity scoring method. They categorize the body into 9 area regions and they categorize the severity in given 6 points according to ordinal scale. Like if it is a very minor, we give it as give 1, moderate 2, if it is serious but which is not life threatening, we give 3. And severe life threatening, but there is a probability of survival, they give 4. And critical survival is quite uncertain, give 5. And maximal or possible fatal, give 6. So this kind of point method we use up to 6 and go to these areas, 9 anatomical areas we use: head, neck, face, chest, pelvic girdle, abdomen and pelvic girdle, spine, upper, lower extremities, and external. how do you calculate this injury severity score here? We select that we give points up to say, we select three more severe region and then get the sum of squares of these three severely injured areas and get calculate the injury severity score. Injury severity score. So it ranges from 1 to 75. It's the single score. This is an important MCQ point. If the single score is 6 of any area, any abbreviated injury region, that automatically total injury severity score comes to 75. If injury severity score is more than 15, which is associated with mortality of nearly 10%. What are the pros and cons here? This advantage is integrate anatomical. They integrate with different anatomical region to formulate and predict the outcome. That is a good way. So we assess multiple areas of the body. That's the advantage. That's a good, that's a positive fact point of this ISS. The disadvantages are, it's difficult to calculate during initial evaluation and resuscitation in the emergency room. Because now they are given scoring 1, 2, 3, 4 according to the severity. So we add, by looking at the patient, we can't give this is minus severe. So we need to resuscitate and get the idea whether it's a severe damage or not. So we can't give an instant. We can't give an instant scoring by using this method. This is one of disadvantage. Another thing is difficult to predict the outcome of the patient with, again, single injury area. Now we are calculating three main severely injured area and assess the ISS, injury severity score. Now we imagine if only one single area is grossly damaged, then we can't, difficult to predict the outcome because at least we need three to calculate. That's a, one of practical point in assessing this, in using this injury severity score. So because of these things, to overcome this drawback, so they have introduced new injury severity score that apply to single body injury to more predict of complications and more mortality than injury severity score. So this could be MCQ in your exam. So remember this thing. And for children, they have modified, again, it's a modified injury severity score. Instead of that 9 areas, they are using only 5 anatomical areas. Other than that, it's the same calculation. Here as well. When you go to the search, that is systemic inflammatory response syndrome. So using heart rate, WBC, respiratory rate, and temperature. These are the things you need to know. This could be MCQs. And to meet this score 2 or more, we categorize this as a systemic inflammatory response syndrome. Okay. Those are the main things, scoring system you need to know about your exam. That's all it is. Do you have any questions or any gray areas I can answer?
Thank you, Ajith, for that brilliant presentation. There are a couple of questions, Ajith. One is, can you elaborate on the early abbreviated care? There's a concept of EAC, right, by Valier.
Yeah. I'm not. I will let you know later because I haven't come across that.
Okay, fine. And the other one is regarding. Suppose you have a clinical scenario where you have a patient with a femur fracture and a tibia fracture.
Okay.
And you're planning for an early total care.
Okay.
And do you do a serum lactate level after doing one surgery? For example, you are doing the femur nailing, and then do you check the serum lactate and then proceed for a tibia nailing?
Of course, yes. That is why I mentioned clearly, even the early total care, that is called, that's a word, it's a constant dynamic approach. That is the word I use because we need to assess during procedure. Because at any point, patient can deteriorate. Now imagine we were ready for the both procedures done and the same go, but we done the seam and nailing, then patient deteriorate. So it is not wise to proceed with the nailing, plating, femur tibial procedure. So we should bail out the procedure. Either we can go the quick external fixator to the tibia and resuscitate, and I will put the patient to the ICU and I will plan it later on once the patient is stable.
Okay, at that moment, would you think that external fix, do you decide based on the lactate levels?
Exactly, yes. Yes, lactate level plus, yeah, lactate plus patient other parameters, ABG, urine output, mainly lactate take it as a, you know, it's a thing we identify patient as in the metabolic acidosis. So I will not proceed, and even though it clearly says in the Bose guideline, if you are going for early total care, we need to reassess during procedure serum venous lactate level.
Okay, that is one concern. I mean, that was one of the questions that we have been put up. The other thing is regarding the mess score.
Okay.
Do you think because we are discussing with the Ganga Hospital score, I think that is off late more and more relevant. I don't know whether you have come across that.
Yeah, I have come across that also, but yes, that is coming to the field gradually, Ganga Hospital scoring system. So in fact, I don't know in the FRCS, if I, as I focus on this FRCS exam, yes, I would say yes, you can talk about new things. Yeah, we don't have to stick on for the MESCO plus, and it is very advanced. Yes, you can mention in your exam. So I think yes, I would say yes.
Okay, because you have cited that in the MESCO, the sensitivity is slightly on the lower
side. Yeah, it is low. Compared to that, Ganga scoring, the hospital scoring system is much more advanced. So I think it is more advanced. You can mention in your exam, yes, this is more lenses. So I'm happy to proceed. And you, they might ask. So new thing, if you come up with a new research, that is the level you can score 7-8. I think that's a good way of score for high mark.
Actually, if you want, if someone wants to see the Ganga Hospital score, we have a lecture recorded by Prof. Rajshekaran itself on our channel. So if someone wants to go through the Ganga Hospital score, you can please share that presentation to them. I can send you the link. There are no more questions, Ajith. I think most of them were very clear. I mean, you have made it very clear, the spectrum of early total care versus damage control orthopedics and the borderline patient as well. So I think since there are no more questions, we wind up the session. Thank you, Dr. Ajith, for that brilliant session.
No problem.
It was very exhaustive. And I think it will contain everything about polytrauma if they ask you for your exams.
Thank you.
Thank you once again, Ajith.
Thank you. No problem.